normal wards that probably don't have safeguarding in which they should, so I really welcome that. Also the child death overview panel. I mean, we know that suicide statistics are not recorded at the National Office of Statistics of those children under 14 15 from suicide. So, you know, welcoming this investigation into children's deaths is absolutely fantastic. And I'd just like to thank you for all your hard work.
Thank you. I just had a question about McLaughlin's leading on the smoking work. So we have the papers we are bringing to you tonight for pre-approval scrutiny, the two strategies that we've developed as part of the Healthy Alliance pledge. So that's the alcohol strategy and the tobacco control strategy. These are two of the actions that are in the Healthy Alliance pledge that we said that we would do. And obviously these are focused on key risk factors for early death and disease, and very much on two of the main areas that are driving the health inequalities in the borough. And I've certainly spoken to you in the past around work that we've done around tobacco control and alcohol. I hope you've seen from the papers that you've got that the strategies were developed in consultation with residents, partners and stakeholders. So we did a lot of work to ensure that a wide range of people have been engaged with the work that we've been doing. Because it's key to us that, as you saw with the Aging Well pledge earlier today, that a wide range of stakeholders are engaged and are actually taking forward the actions that are within the strategies. Both strategies also include a wide range of policy and service issues. I think it's really important that we focus on the policy issues that need to be taken forward, alongside making sure that we have strong treatment services for those people who want to stop smoking or are drinking to excess. So you'll see that certainly in the alcohol strategy, we've got work in there around influencing government policy around minimum unit price, for example. And with regard to tobacco control, we've got actions in there around working with trading standards colleagues around tackling illegal tobacco. I'm not going to say very much more because the papers hopefully are self-explanatory. And obviously, we've brought them here today. There's still work to do on them, as you can see, prior to going to cabinet. For approval, but obviously come today to hear your views and to help us shape the strategies going forward.
Thanks, Julie, and I'm sure there will be questions and comments from around the table. I'd just like to say that they are very good strategies in my opinion. I'm really pleased to see that both of them are really driven by the cabinet chairs, and that's good to see here tonight. Well done for the strategies, and we're going to open up now for questions and comments. Wendy?
Yes,
it's for age, David. There's Wendy, David, Treena, and then Angie. I should forget Angie's name just to make it even.
Thank you, Chair. Great to see that we're moving forward and trying to increase things. I was thinking about the aspiration to make it that children don't start smoking and how hard that is. I went to, some time ago, a peer educators thing we did in Wirral, which was about alcohol, but I wondered if we've got something similar going on around peer educators helping children and young people not to start smoking.
Yes, the answer is that it's, we've got lots we can learn from the models that are already happening in Wirral, and definitely something around smoking we looked to develop a few years ago. We worked around the peer education model, and something that we're looking to strengthen going forward. So it happens, it's happening in pockets of areas. What we need to do is make it more consistent so there's a universal reach around that peer. But it's definitely the way forward around working with young people is that peer, it's the peer influencer from a positive angle.
David?
Thank you. I sit on licensing and it's been quite a joy really to try and stop some of the cumulative impact of off licences appearing, particularly in Birmingham airports. And I've been very supportive of particular councillors who obviously come forward to stop them being given a licence. I'm just wondering if there's an opportunity through that to do something around smoking, because obviously it's quite obvious that an off licence, the less off licences, presumably the less likely somebody is to buy alcohol, and that stops the street drinkers. But it's a slightly different thing with the smoking. And I'm just wondering if anything that I'm doing on licensing could be extended to support what you're trying to do with regards to smoking.
There absolutely is. So the whole concept of a responsible retailer is definitely something we want to investigate and want to do that with obviously officer colleagues and councillors. So is that
good?
Regionally, there was some discussion around looking at a positive tobacco retailers scheme, and that
requires that.
But it doesn't stop us doing it.
Not at all, not at all, no. It's just good to know that it's going to go a wider footprint. Yeah.
Can I just say that when we did the cumulative impact policy review, and I know Jeanette was involved in the early stages, one of the things that actually I think is Councillor Gilchrist brought to our attention was that some local authorities have developed particular planning briefs around, say, reducing the number of fast food outlets around schools that have an exclusion zone, if you like. And they're the kind of, and I know that you were keen when you talked to us during that meeting with the job people to use both planning and licensing policies more vigorously, if you like, to support this public health agenda. Yeah, I take a minute of water. Take Treena and Angie, then you water, and then you talk.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. I would just like to thank Councillor Jeanette Williamson for the press release that went out yesterday on the plan to see local agencies and people licensed authorities have bodies coming together and the second phase of the local authority action areas. And in particular, how we're going to deliver that strategy. My interest would be reducing the strength scheme, because I know that's a very good scheme that I know people looked at, met with Carol here about it. And I just wanted to know if there's anything more being done to roll this out, because it's a brilliant scheme, and I just don't know how far you've got with it. I mean, we're very limited in what we can do, I suppose, as an authority. But if you could just give us some more information on
that. I mean, I've been quite amazed at the way that the retailers have taken up reducing the strength scheme, particularly in Birkenhead. The only thing I suppose that's holding us back really is capacity, because obviously there's a lot of work that needs to be done with retailers through our environmental health colleagues. So it's really a case of just having to program it into their work programme. So there's definitely, you know, great engagement in Birkenhead. We do want to see it rolled out further, but it's just going to be about how the capacity to do that.
That was kind of my question really as well, that I know it's been very, very successful, both, you know, from kind of people that are shopping in there, kind of, even the street drinkers themselves like it, don't know about them, that the kind of volumes being reduced really. In terms of 30%, I know there's a lot of licences on the Wirral. I just felt, and I know it's a capacity issue, but I felt it's something we should be more ambitious about. You know, because it also has an impact in terms of anti-social behaviour. So I think about my own one friend, and there was somebody that spoke to me about a sweet shop that has just got a licence to sell alcohol, and it's by a school, by an apprentice in high school, and now that shop, all the front, it just used to be sweets, and it was just alcohol with a very small sweet counter. So I'm just wondering about, you know, taking into account the capacity issues.
Absolutely, and I think probably targeting as well from what you're saying. So there's something for us to take back, and I think that would link maybe with the cumulative impact policy, because that's then about how we bring all the data together so that we can target. And that takes me to the local alcohol action area that we've just become one of 33, I think, is in the country. And one of the real drivers for that is about sharing data across partners, so that we can get the data together to support the decisions that are being made back by yourselves.
Thank you, Chair. I want to comment on the inquiry recommendations on page 134, the top one. It's more of just a comment, really. We had an incident in Burlington some years ago where we had an off license, and the shop next door wanted to change into an off license. So we objected, and of course, I told by the planners, there are no reasons to object on planning grounds. So we said, well, so you could all open six off licenses next to each other, and you could have. And I see now it's becoming the thing they recognise, that the ready availability of alcohol is one of the problems in our society. I mean, I think you'd have to be my age. I remember the days when there was no such place, the only place for off license was in the pub, and they had a little counter that you went, you get a few bottles. But now, we all know with our shopping experience, you go to the supermarket with these masses of bottles, and you know, buy one and get a second pack of booze if you want it. And it is so readily available for those people that, you know, can't resist drinking. It is a temptation. So that was just a comment I want to make, is that we certainly ought to be looking to see that we restrict the number of off-licences so that we are promoting drink all the time for people.
Established. And that was the principle that was done away with in the 2003 Act.
it in other areas and hasn't been successful?
It's variable in other areas of anti-six. It very much depends on the stance of the organisation. Public Health England have updated their smoke-free policy last November, and in it, it has a position statement around e-cigarettes. Very similar to the organisation's stance, but it is very clear that it is a harm reduction tool. So the smoke-free policy, there is a smoke policy has been written, and it's sitting with the council HR at the moment to ensure we already have smoke-free policy. It's been added to include e-cigarettes, the permission of use of e-cigarettes within the grounds, not within the buildings, within the grounds. So that's sitting for consultation at the moment. And then there will be some view to see how we can work with other organisations to adopt a similar policy. But it very much depends on the organisation's stance.
Okay.
I'm just wondering if maybe it's some of our language that we've used here, because I think what we're trying to get at is we have a number of different agencies that are smoke-free, but we're not necessarily joining that all up together. So this was about sharing good practice.